Unpopular opinions are a dime a dozen occurrence in the online hellscape of today. There's a fairly large subreddit dedicated to such statements. This particular image has to have appeared on everyone's Facebook feed at least once or twice, and there have been times in my online classes when I arrived at conclusions on the content of the lectures that were very different from that which my instructors were trying to convey. To say all this when preempting this proof of concept may very well allow for everyone else to view what I am about to do as another drop in the bucket. I can see why, but knowing me personally would perhaps rationalize why it is happening. The dormancy of this channel over the course of a year now is something I'm not proud of, and if I was to finally find redemption, it would need to truly be something else while also returning to my roots. This is Bashing Your Favorite Album, and it begins with something that I just know is not going to win me any new friends. The 1998 album from Gorguts, Obscura.
Bashing your favorite album.
It was true then, during its beginnings in the mid-1980s, in places such as Florida, New York, and Sweden, and it's still true, almost 40 years later when existing on a global scale, death metal was and still is the one subgenre of metal best known for near-constant high-tempo tracks, blast beats, and low-to-mid-pitched guitar riffs. Being the first snow Mexicans to emulate Cannibal Corpse or Immolation, alongside Cryptopsy, Luke, Carlo, Steph, and Gary were no exceptions to such characteristics when recording their 89 demo. Luke LeMay is the only one out of the four to have appeared on every Gorguts release, including ones as recent as 2013's Colored Sands and 2016's Pleiades Dust. However, in the time between the inception and the resurgence of Gorguts, there would come the 1991 debut, Considered Dead. Recorded in Morris Sound in Tampa, which is where Obituary and Death recorded a good chunk of their respective 90s discographies, every track on here is 3 to 4 minutes of that which is quintessential to the genre. 93 rolled around with the marginally more nuanced Erosion of Sanity. Something was ostensibly different being done to the vocals to make them more audible alongside the instrumentation, and in addition to ominous acoustic guitars making a comeback on the closer Dormant Misery, they were also using ominous pianos in passages of Condemned to Obscurity. There was also at least one slower tempo passage on a good chunk of the track listing, namely With Their Flesh Healer Create, the chorus on Orphans of Sickness, and the second half of A Path Beyond Premonition, which that particular track, it well makes it seem as if they had taken a page out of a Spix or Autopsy's playbook. It is said that by the end of 93, the writing process for their third album had been completed. The execs at Roadrunner Records, clearly not in possession of a crystal ball, decided to end their deal with Gorguts due to a perceived decline in the popularity of death metal. The entirety of Erosion's lineup had also quit that year, with the exception of LeMay. LeMay once pontificated in a 2015 interview with Banger TV that it was also around this time that he had started taking violin lessons and had gone down a classical music rabbit hole, which appears to have contributed greatly to his philosophical approach to writing music. Shortly after relocating to Montreal in 1995 and inking a deal with Olympic Records, the lineup would then consist of LeMay, drummer Patrick Robert, bassist Steve Coltier, and guitarist Steve, that's with two E's, not E, not one E, Steve Hurdle, who passed away in 2012. Gorguts to have implemented these new ideas in the songwriting took a considerable amount of time to truly achieve vindication. The dissonant, sludgy, low-pitched guitars, slow tempos, and odd time signatures are the major constants here. And there are many newer extreme metal acts whose sound can be traced back to Obscura, which includes the German band that named themselves after the album, blindfolded and led to the woods, artificial brain, suffering hour, death spell omega, light dweller, portal, I guess to some extent tomb mold, and because it just wouldn't be a discussion of this album's legacy without mentioning them, ulcerate. I would be right for the wrong reasons if I called this album brilliant without pointing that out. At best, we can hold it in a purely retrospective regard by calling it ahead of its time and serving as a game changer in a time when the genre needed something like that the most. And at worst, it insists upon itself and has garnered all this notoriety through no fault of its own. It doesn't matter which way you want to look at it because it sticks out like a sore thumb. Why do I say this? Well, seconds after putting the CD in your computer or car, or dropping the needle on the edge of the A side, or doing what I did, which is clicking the YouTube link containing the album, you're greeted with this. That technical wankery that can't even be called a riff. It's more the rule than it is the exception, and that right there is quite possibly a tamer example. It sounds as if LeMay had suffered a concussion, a brain aneurysm, and intense muscle spasms in his arms all within minutes of each other, and while his hands happened to be on the guitar. Shortly after I revisited the first three Gorguts albums, I've come to realize that I appreciate LeMay way more as a vocalist than I do as a guitarist, and all I have to do in order to continually convince myself of this is listen to a track from Obscura and then a track from Considered Dead or Erosion of Sanity back to back, because he literally uses the same vocal style on all three, which is the low-pitched death growls, and yet it somehow manages to be pretty fucking distracting on Obscura. I do, however, have to shout out somebody named Rostowski in the comments section of the YouTube version of the album. He points out that Steve also did some vocals on this album, which they describe as, and I quote, ghostly moaning of the 666th dimension. The next track, Earthly Love, there is an actual riff. It is a little bit muddied down by the rhythm section and the drums, but the first half of this 4-minute track really does lend some credence to the claim that the writing process for this album was completed in late 93. The second half, however, is when they take a moment to just throw some shit at the wall. It's a very percussion-centric passage, and what I'll say here is that what does save this album from being totally irredeemable is whenever Patrick Robert gets some time to shine. The mid-tempo bass notes are also slightly audible, more here than they were the minute prior. LeMay also plays some notes on the viola for no reason, and the half-baked riffage does make a comeback only for a few seconds. In other words, they went nowhere fast. On the Cardinal State, there's a particular groove to it in the beginning, not to mention mid-pitched bass notes that are easily audible. That doesn't exactly mesh well with that one note progression that we hear from the guitars that we hear 5 to 7 times. Oh, there's this fucking nonsense. Yeah, that wasn't even the worst fucking part. Like, those vocals that are done, like, I took notes the first several times I listened to each track, and I had it written down here that I'm reminded of high-pitched Eric from the Howard Stern Show with those particular screams for whatever goddamn reason. In other words, it's the third consecutive noisy fever dream. And we got nine more to go here. Nostalgia is the first in the track listing to exceed 5 minutes, and to say that this is where they turn things up to 11 would be quite possibly the biggest understatement I've ever made in my life. There's something very hypnotic about all that is going on in the beginning, with the incessant droning from the guitars that, again, can't even be called a riff. Though I will say that the tone in the bass when we hear that same series of notes is marginally more bearable. Let's take a listen. There's also an abrupt few seconds of build-up leading to that which takes up a good chunk of the second half of this track that almost sounds like nu metal. Basically, when it's not stagnant and monotonous within mere seconds, it's dating itself in the worst ways possible. All throughout The Art of Somber Ecstasy, Patrick Robert is doing a lot of double pedaling and a lot of intricate drum fills, and then towards the end there's some intense cymbal smashing. Then there's this one note progression that appears about a minute and a half in, and it sounded cool in the first two times, but then it got pretty annoying. The dissonant atonal guitars and the high-pitched screams were also in full force, as you could probably tell by that guitar solo of sorts, as well as what was on here seconds prior. Again, the vigorous nature of the drumming saves this from being a complete clusterfuck, and everything else about it has only worked in the context of only so many other metal songs that have been written after it. The next track is the longest one on the album, and is at a consistently slow tempo in its near 10-minute runtime. I am, of course, talking about Clouded. I see some people who do like this album, and they call it their least favorite. My view of it is the inverse. The abrasive and occasionally overbearing tone of LeMay and Hurdle's guitars, as well as the cold and calculated nature of Robert's drumming, mesh very well with the structure of the song here. The amalgamations of notes, while they also can't even be called riffs, it's significantly easier to immerse myself in this track when it's some slow droning. Take a listen. It still manages to just be a tad bit difficult to get through just because of, well, you know. What the fuck? If you can believe it, we're now halfway through this fucking thing when we get to only the second shortest track of the album, Subtle Body. It does start off strong enough, thanks in large part to all that Patrick Robert is doing.
Subtle
you may also be able to tell by those guitars that this almost comes across as a happy medium between the orthodox song structures of the first two albums and the experimental nature of this one, which runs rampant pretty much everywhere else. Of course, this was the idea when they were writing 2001's From Wisdom to Hate, but that's neither here nor there. For no reason, the last minute or so features this slower passage with back-to-back bass solos and a guitar solo of sorts. Then it's just a repeat of the start of the track that we just heard. Without question, it is the least jarring and bizarre track out of all 12, but it's still not great just because of one of the few of the reasons that I've already pointed out earlier. Rapturous Grief, in its first minute and a half or so, is pretty by the numbers, at least within the context of the rest of the album. Of course, the album itself is anything but by the numbers, especially when you consider what death metal was like at the time. It has that sludgy guitar work going at a medium tempo, and it stops for just a few seconds, and then the vocals come in, and they do even more of what they were just doing. The ridiculousness of the vocals is at its apex here. Just listen to how the name of the song is yelled. The tempo drastically goes up the very next second, as you just heard, but it's not a very eventful remaining 4 minutes, with the exception of what I think is supposed to be a guitar solo with this unfitting change in the tone. The intensity in the drumming from Patrick Robert is at the forefront again on the next track, La Vie est Prelude. And that is interesting to think about just because it is a consistently mid-tempo track. It may have something to do with the frequent shifts in time signatures. We can also hear them delving into a sort of, again, new metal or maybe even a Primus territory with this cold, calculated groove in the guitars, as well as this one passage where the bass is significantly louder than everything else and there's this echoing effect on the vocals. Let's take a listen. We get to hear that passage again during the last minute of the track, and it's preempted by just some more technical wankery and some straightforward double pedaling and drum fills that seemingly went on longer than they actually did. It managed to be very engaging and had an adventurous structure to it, and such a description really only applies to the longer songs here. There is one small issue, though. Speaking of longer songs, Illuminatus had a solid start to it with this steady groove in the guitars. It does, however, get bogged down pretty quickly by, you guessed it, From then on, it's slightly slower passage with some repetitive rhythms. They make one sound many times that sounds like the pick sliding up one of the strings. It doesn't get good per se until this breakdown of sorts with lots of double pedaling, and all that does is preempt this dumb guitar solo here. There is a reappearance of a lot of the note progressions from before, and for some reason, the last minute or so is just them drastically slowing down with almost no notice, and they seem to be playing a bunch of different notes and then hitting drums and cymbals at random. It'd be one thing if that was how the track started, and it could be called a slow build-up or a crescendo, but maybe I'm expecting way too fucking much out of this, given the minute and a half of noisy, nightmarish nonsense that preceded that final part. Baseless Ones is another short one, and it starts off well enough with this Erosion of Sanity vibe for like 30 seconds. The rest is just this elongated breakdown, followed by even more technical wankery. That cool riff does reappear right around the 2-minute mark, but there isn't exactly much else to comment on here. And then, it's finally over after the instrumental closer, Sweet Silence. And you better fucking believe that this one is my favorite from the album. Why? A, it's over 6 consecutive minutes of not having to hear this fucking bullshit. And B, listen to this intense percussion in the first 45 seconds. They do cover quite a few bases in terms of the guitar work, in that each 20 to 30 seconds interval is pretty much different from the one that follows it. It alternates from ominous acoustic guitars like the ones we just heard just now, to directionless shredding, to even more technical wankery. But of course, another big highlight here is those foreboding creaking sounds that we sporadically hear during the last minute and a half of the track. Like many of the people who I see commenting on that particular passage, I do remember being weirded out bigly the first time I heard it, which had to have been probably mid to late 2010. There are even people who are still scared about it every time they hear it. I just think it's pretty fucking funny whenever I get to that part from now on. Gorguts could have easily stuck with the formula of no-nonsense tremolos and blast beats when writing their third album, and it may have been just as popular with the same crowd that heaped praise upon their first two albums. There's just something about the fact that they didn't, which demands a fair amount of respect from some of us younger death metal fans. In an online space as diverse as Rate Your Music, a mostly positive consensus continues to befall this record after all these years. But over at Metal Archives and MetalStorm.net, the discourse of it is way more divisive. When investigating what the YouTube sphere had to say about this record, I stumbled upon somebody named Naomi, who runs a channel called 365 Days of Prague. She fully admits to not being a fan of any extreme metal in her review of this album, but her enjoyment of it had a lot to do with, and I quote, "a gradual and slow shift of tone in the music, like in such a slow pace that you really have to immerse yourself in it to feel the changes going on." And you can tell at this point that I tried with all of my might to keep an open mind about Obscura, which I would say has been very true since around the time when I got to work on making this video in May of this year. Death metal just kept getting weirder and more out there during the last 15 to 20 years, but at an expense of this sort, it was pretty hard to wrap my head around that at first. Sue. So.